And well, they basically asked me to come to Groundswell this year in order to communicate a little bit about the know-how we build up in France. Well, I started basically more around 1985. I was coming back from United States at that time, and I worked on from 82 to 85, first as a student, but then I was a foreman on different farms in the United States, and I've seen the first people trying to fight erosion by keeping the residue on the top of the soil. I thought it was quite a great idea, and back in France, I started thinking it could be applied in my country and in my land. So we tried on my father's and mother's farm. It was pretty a failure at the beginning. It didn't work, and so it convinced my father that what's work in America will not work in France. But and then after a different, you know, meeting. I start being in contact with Horsch, Michael Horsch, and that helped me to have a wider range of knowledge, and we're starting to put different things in it and finally find ways to make it work on my farm and other French farms. We probably have 30 years of journey, and we had to find a way through. Today, I mean, most of the things are and are known. So there is better equipment, managing soil fertility and soil structure is better known. We know that this is very important to have cover crops, and we know how to manage diversity of the cropping sequences. So, I mean, the knowledge is has been built up all those 25 years. So it's a lot less risky now today to get into the adventure. The first thing they probably would have to do is to get the knowledge, you know, to try to see other farmers, not only farmers they look like them, but farmers they are probably in different type of weather, different type of soil, and different type of crops, in order to build their own knowledge, and in order to make their mind, and because the knowledge is probably what is the most missing out of it, and then give it a go. You know, if you think it's the right way to do, well, go for it. But try as a way you're getting into it, try to gather other farmers and keep, you know, having people helping to make the right decision, just like farming, it will not be an easy journey. Farming is not an easy whatsoever you do. But, well, there is no way you will not be successful, as I've seen many farmers being successful in different parts of the world, in different weather, with different crops, and with plenty of challenge. You know, if many people come to you and say, I have a problem. No, it is a challenge. It is a challenge, and that you can overcome many, many challenges with conservation agriculture. If you look, there is plenty of tillage around the world, and there is plenty of weeds. And the guys that have the biggest tillage equipment, usually they have big sprayers as well. If you look on the other side of organic farming, well, they do a lot of tillage. They do have a lot of weeds. So weeds is more complicated than having just one tools or agrochemicals or tillage and things like that. And because we had to work with weeds, we found ways to overcome weeds, I would say a smarter way. And probably the most smarter way at the moment is we plant a companion crop in our oilseed rape, and basically we choose our weeds. Instead of having plants that grow because they want to grow, we try to fill the ecologic niche by other plants that we call companion plants. And now when I plant oilseed rape, I probably put 3, 4, 5, 6 plants with my oilseed rapes, and they will fade down during the winter, but they will help not having to spray, because usually when you have weeds is because you have a hole in the system. So you fill the hole with plants you can manage, and you probably get less weeds. I don't want to make the picture too nice, you know. Okay, it's still our problem, but least big problem in conservation agriculture today. Glyphosate is making a big buzz at the moment around the world, and especially in France. I mean, I think we are maybe in the leading country talking about that, and our other President Macron saying that he will ban glyphosate in 3 years, really put a lot of pressure on us because we are using glyphosate. So I will have a kind of two answers. First, it is important to have debate about risk and debate about agrochemical risk. And this putting some pressure on farmers to change the way they do, and also helping the research, helping companies trying to find other solutions, you know, not relying on old solution all the time. But on the other hand, saying you will ban glyphosate in 3 years and leave all the people that have done conservation agriculture and develop it and help to stop erosion, store carbon in the soil. And I sometimes say to people, I save 50 liters of fuel per hectare myself every year, which is 1,000 kilometers driving with a normal car on each hectare. So only that for 1 liter of glyphosate. Well, we already reduced the agrochemical usage quite a lot without the political pressure, just because we wanted to do that, because it's good. Just give us time, okay? And we will go further, and we will even go better than what you think we could do, because we probably be able to reduce even more glyphosate, but the agrochemicals and even the fertilizer, and have better soil life, and also use a lot less energy to farm. If you ban glyphosate straight away, well, we will be lost without a easy solution, a kind of parachute, you know. So a lot of farmers will not get into that system, and I don't think agriculture will be better. I'm sure agriculture will be even going down instead of looking at a brighter future. I think there is a place for organic farming, and the place of organic farming has to be for a certain market, because people want organic product. But there is also a big place for conservation agriculture, or some sort of conservation agriculture. There is still a place, would be still a place for industrial type of agriculture, because there is stuff that need to be supplied at a big amount. It will be more direct selling things, you know, so we will reduce the global exchange. It will be more direct, and farmers are to get more to marketing their own stuff to the consumer, and consumer knowing more the farmers, whether they're organic or not organic. And then I think we have to promote not a model like we used to. This one is the right model, this one is a bad one. We have to help to diversify the agriculture's models, and more diversity we will have, better we will increase the resilience of our agriculture, and this diversity will also help to feed the innovation for even better agriculture in the future. If we stick agriculture into one model compared to another one, I mean, it would not be good. We have to promote once again diversity in the field, diversity in the mind, but diversity in the way we organize agriculture.